Good morning. Great to see so many with us here this morning. Thank you so much for coming. Today we celebrate a proud tradition of inclusion and championing diversity in our communities. It's natural to look back to see where we began, but more importantly, it's important to look forward to where this momentum can take us in the years ahead of us, where we dream of being. This year, this event continues to grow significantly, evidence that our city and that our county supports business diversity, and that when you create events and reasons for people to come together in the name of business, they find common ground. We're here today in part thanks to the efforts of our Chattanooga Chamber's Diversity and Inclusion Group, led by Maria Noel. This effort continues to develop businesses in the greater Chattanooga area, both established and emerging businesses, to do business together. Our chamber strives to be a civic model for inclusion because it's the right thing to do and also because it makes good business sense. Your work here, your support of our marketplace, advances productivity, innovation, and economic growth, as well as diversity. I'd like to recognize first our officials, elected officials, are here with us today. I'm slightly out of breath because I ran over from the county commission meeting, so maybe I beat them here. But thanks always to their support and their help. Mayor Coppinger for leading our county forward and everything that you do and all the support that you give to diversity and our city business model as well. Mayor Burke is out of town and could not be here today. In his place is James McKissick, who is the Director of Multicultural Affairs for our city. He works so hard in City Hall to make sure that goals such as those we share here this morning and others come to fruition. I'll admit that I'm torn right now between this event of celebration and the events of the last week. Our hearts go out to those who have lost loved ones in Charleston. Our hearts also go to the family of James Mapp, who is to be celebrated here in Chattanooga, and I'm so honored and so pleased that his daughters would be with here at this event together this morning. I don't know any other way but the Chattanooga way just to give them a round of applause for their father and for everything he did for us. Thank you, ladies, again so much for being with us this morning. Thank you for the spirit that you carry forward for your father. I'd like now to introduce both Gary Hathaway and Jermaine Periphery. Gary is going to lead us in the invocation, and James will follow him immediately. Those of you who were here in 2010 remember that James was a finalist in that TV show that we love to watch so much. So thank you so much for being here as well.
Let us pray.
Our Father and our God, we give you glory on this day, for the heavens and the earth declare your glory. We praise you for who you are, and we realize this is the day that you have made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. We thank you for life, for we realize in you we live, we move, and we have our being. We thank you for our community and our nation, for the freedoms that we enjoy to work, to play, to serve, and to do business. We pray now your continued blessings upon the victims, families, and the community of Charleston. We pray for the Mapp family as well. Pray that you might strengthen them during their time of need. We're so grateful for the chamber, all of its leaders, and pray for all that are here today, continued blessings upon you, and that this program might accomplish its purpose. We pray blessings upon our speaker and give thanks for the provisions that they might provide health and strength. In the name of the Son, we pray. Amen.
Oh, say, Can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the
Thank you, Gary, and thank you, Jermaine. Maria Noel has overseen the Chamber's diversity and inclusion efforts for the past 3 years. Through her work, bringing together suppliers and outstanding managers across this city, our multicultural participation in our business models has grown each year. How does she make this happen? Maria will tell you that the key to her success is bringing together major employers here with small businesses and then helping small businesses outreach to the business that want to work with them. I can just tell you personally that it's great to work with someone who has the passion for this mission and executes it so well as she does. Maria, please come on up and join me on the stage. Thanks so much for what you do.
Please, in the interest of time, go ahead and enjoy your meals. We just want to thank some people who, without their support, we would not have this program today. So we'd like to recognize our sponsors. Our presenting sponsor is Blue Cross Blue Shield of Tennessee. Our platinum sponsors are EPB, NovaCopy, Sandler Training, and Volkswagen.
Our gold sponsors, Tennessee American Water, Unum, Vision Hospitality.
Silver sponsors, Chambliss, Bonner, and Stoffel PC, Chattanooga Airport, Chattanooga Technology Council, Chatham Inc., Cohutta Banking Company, Elliott Davis DeCosimo, Henderson Hutcherson McCullough PLLC, Lattimore Black Morgan and Kane, Malden and Jenkins, LLC, SunTrust Bank, Tandis Centiva, Tennessee Valley Federal Credit Union, WGU, Tennessee. Our media sponsors, Brewer Media, Chattanooga Times Free Press, CMC Publications, CityScope and HealthScope Magazines, Coffee News, Cumulus Media Chattanooga, Nash Icon 107.9, Fairway Outdoor, iHeart Media, Partners for Christian Media, J103, The Pulse, WDEF FM Sunny 92.3, WDSI Fox 61, WRCB TV Channel 3, Eyewitness News, WSMC Classical 90.5, WTCI TV PBS, WTVC News Channel 9, and YP. Please enjoy your lunch, and the remainder of our program will resume in just a moment. And let's give our sponsors a hand, please. Thank you. And thank you once again. I do want you to please continue eating. Please continue the conversations, of course, after I speak. But continue and make sure before you leave this room, you look around the room and you see how diverse and how wonderful you all look here. And we're so honored to have you here. And also, before you leave, I want to make sure you get some great bargains outside. We've got some magnificent businesses that we want to support. So please make sure you stop by, talk to the businesses, see what services they have to offer, and shop. Thank you. At this time, I would like to recognize the members of the Diversity and Inclusion Advisory Board. And I'm going to ask the members to please stand and remain standing while I call your names, and for the audience to wait until we complete the names before we give the applause. We've got Sharita Adams, co-owner and marketing director for Blue Orleans Seafood Restaurant. Jacinto Blanco, supplier, diversity manager for Blue Cross Blue Shield of Tennessee. Hal Bowling, co-founder and executive director of Launch Chattanooga. Michael Hayes, co-owner of The Dollar Store on ML King Boulevard and owner of Hayes Network Inc. Michael Jones, manager of minority and women-owned business development for EPB. Keith Landaker, operations manager for Brewer Media. Kiki Mathis, supplier diversity manager for Volkswagen. Paul Middlebrooks, marketing consultant for the University of Tennessee's Procurement Technical Assistance Center. James Miller, vice president of retail banking for First Tennessee Bank. Bill Pollard, vice president of Brightbridge. Keitha Richardson, purchasing manager for EPB. Deirdre Thomas, marketing director for Hoskins and Company CPAs. And Velma Wilson, owner of Cleaning Solutions, LLC. Please give them a round of applause. Thank you. Now, in the past year, three companies in particular stand out in terms of their support for the Chamber's diversity initiatives. At this time, I would like to invite Jim Brewer of Brewer Media, Calvin Anderson of Blue Cross Blue Shield of Tennessee, and Michael Jones of EPB to join me on the stage. Thank you. To honor their commitment, the advisory board and I would like to recognize them for going above and beyond in supporting our initiatives. Brewer Media helped African American businesses gain unparalleled visibility throughout the year. Blue Cross Blue Shield helped us make an important connection with today's speaker. And the firm has a global reputation for engaging a wide variety of minority-owned firms. And EPB advocates daily for our programs throughout our community, and they continue to provide much-needed support for local diverse firms. Please join me in a round of applause for these three champions of diversity, as well as for our outstanding local artist, Isaac Duncan, who created these one-of-a-kind sculptures. Okay. And our president and CEO, Bill Kilbride, will present them with these awards. These are just small tokens of our appreciation for all that you all have done for us. And we thank you so much. Yeah, you can. And by the way, next year we hope to see some of you up here, okay? Again, thank you all so much for your support. Thank you. Oh, one more. And now Bill Kilbride will introduce Calvin Anderson, who will introduce our keynote speaker. Thank you.
Thank you, Maria. Calvin Anderson doesn't need any introduction, but you know, I would never miss an opportunity to do this. This would be my first time, and I hope to be able to do it many, many more times because he's such a remarkable gentleman. Calvin is a native of Memphis. Calvin oversees government relations, community relations, the foundation at Blue Cross, and public affairs. He serves on the diversity committee for Blue Cross Blue Shield. Over his 20-year career, Calvin has worked as a U.S. Senate staffer. He served in the leadership role with the State Election Commission, as well as with the 8th District of the Federal Reserve System. He's the previous vice chair of the Memphis Chamber Board. We don't hold that against him. And the Health Industry Council there as well. He is a 2015, which makes it recent, graduate of the Leadership Tennessee program. Please join me in welcoming Calvin to the podium.
Bill, thank you for that great introduction. You know, if you get the opportunity to sit with Janice Bryant Howard, you learn things right off the bat. And I found out one of her secrets to success is that you start with dessert and work from there. You know, it's been said that the journey of 1,000 miles began with a single step. That first step is often the hardest, but taking it often defines the success of the journey. I'm honored to introduce and present to you Janice Bryant Howard. You will read from her extensive bio the steps she took starting at North Carolina State A&T and the pursuit of that ever-elusive first job. You will note that Ms. Howard took a bold step to start a full-time placement firm in 1978 with commitment, family support, and a small initial investment. You will note that Janice Bryant Howard consistently applied the principles of business to grow Apple One Staffing into a multi-billion dollar success story, employing thousands and along the way building a reputation for excellence. She's been recognized by her peers, business and civic leaders, with honors and recognitions that are far too numerous to list, but now allow me to name a few. Harvard University Women Leadership Board, North Carolina State A&T Board of Trustees, and Forbes Magazine, number 24 on the list of self-made women millionaires. However, like so many of you, the real success and life satisfaction for Janice comes with the attachment to her family. We are again honored and privileged to have this success story in our presence. But before we give a Chattanooga welcome, I invite you to follow her on Twitter, @JBryantHoward. And she is tweeting out from the very luncheon today. So we will see a short introductory video, and then you will hear from Janice Bryant Howard.
She's the founder of a corporate empire worth over $3 billion.
Act One is one of the largest staffing companies in the United States.
She's taken on the corporate world. Now, Janice Bryant Howard is ready to share her secrets for success.
I'm from a small town, Tarver, North Carolina. There are 11 children in our family. Our mom and dad ran the family like a business. Dad was the president and mom was the COO. And I think a lot of what I learned about life and about business, I learned from how my home operated. Dad always taught us, don't look around you to see what your opportunities are. Look inside yourself for them. We really grew up with that. For me, the moment was defining what I would do. And that occurred in Los Angeles.
In 1978, Janice parlayed $1,500 and a single phone line.
Our first office was actually the front of a rug shop.
Into a global staffing and technology empire worth over $3 billion.
My first big customer is still one of my best customers. Mama was right. If you treat them right, they stay with you.
Named one of Essence Magazine's 50 most inspiring African Americans and Ebony's 100 most influential Black Americans, a committed volunteer and mentor who's helped thousands realize their own dreams.
In order for mentoring to be effective, it also has to be an equal investment. Mm-hmm. Let's flip over and now let's start to see what you bring to the relationship.
She's already a sought-after motivational speaker.
I want you to applaud yourselves right now. Let's do it. Come on.
Talk show guest.
We have to think of ourselves as entrepreneurs.
And an expert on success.
I've got a lot of years, 30 years of experience building a business successfully. Those are experiences that people need to hear about, need to know about, and most importantly, they can learn from them. Never once have I changed anybody's life. What I do believe I've done is encouraged, inspired, and shown people how to change their own lives. I will not participate with the naysayers who say it's over for America or it's over for the American worker. What I say is, look at what we've really got working for us and put that to work.
Janice is ready to help America find success and balance in their own lives.
I just can't wait to help people to understand what my journey is like and, more importantly, what their journey can be like.
I'm not a stage speaker, and I refuse to fall down in these stilettos. But I was asked by Mayor Jim if I would just come to the stage for a few minutes, so I'm going to open my conversation with you from the stage. My expectation is that we're going to have a visit, and I'm not going to do a speech. And I hope you're aligned with that. Before I share anything further with you, allow me first to give honor and praise to my Creator. It is so wonderful to be able to be in an environment where I can say that and have it received with a welcome. You know, we're in a very particular time in this world today where we're all confused about where we're going, but we've all got definite wishes and passions around getting there. I think then that this moment you're having is so important to something that's not just an event, but that is a way of life. People vote as an event. People go to church on Easter as an event. But to really institute within your life and your lifestyle what you care most about is what gets you there. And those of you sitting in this audience who are on your path of success, none of us are over with it, I pray. Those of you who are on your path of success, I think will agree with me that it's one thing to have a speech or have a voting opportunity or have a marketplace event. It's another thing to really institute those things that we care most about inside of our lives and to learn from others how they've been able to do that. So, Mayor Jim, have you got your pictures and can I get down off this stage now? Thank you. Thank you so much. And I do invite you all to join me on Twitter as well, Janice Bryant Howroyd. Now, at Janice Bryant Howroyd. Now, as I come down these steps, I'm inviting each of you to think about what you want to hear from me today. I do speak globally, and very often I have a theme that I'm following. Usually it's attached to what the event or what the organization is about. But today, because we're in a particular moment in this country and in this world where we are all, we have some reasons to be sad as well as some to be glad, I think it'll be great if we just kind of take it to church. And I'm not speaking denominationally. I don't mind where you go for your spiritual uplift. You're aware of where I go. I've shared that publicly on many occasions. But the important thing is that no matter who you call God, you just call God every day. And then more importantly, you shut up and listen. All right? Now, amen? Now, I'm not going to suppose to you that I come here with a spiritual uplifting message for you. There are some very basic business elements of importance that I think we want to talk about. So I'm going to take two or three questions right now, and from those, I'm going to build my conversation with you. It would be so easy to share with you my ABCs of success. It would be a privilege to share with you my talk on how belief, and not belief spiritually, but just belief in the process, can build a business. It would be thrilling for me to share with you my womb theory. It is, I think, fundamentally appropriate in this season that I talk with you about things that matter to you. So, by show of hands, and I think somebody has a mic, yes? Okay, it's kind of dark in here. I don't know if you can see her, but she's standing right here. By show of hands, I'm taking two or three questions up front, and I'm going to build my conversation from that today. I'm going to make myself open to answer those things that really are important to you, because it would be great to think that I had shared with you, and you listened. Here's a hand right back here, please. And you listened and got something. Here's a hand over here for the second mic. But it's more important that I'm sharing with you from where you need to know. And I'll tell you stuff as well. This is a third and a fourth and a fifth, and then we're going to start talking. All right? Please give your name, and because this is a business event, give your affiliation as well. Don't make a speech. Ask a question.
Good afternoon. I'm Crystal McLemore, and I recently opened my own MetLife insurance agency. My question is, or in the, you know, community, or just negative aspects that tries to affect you while you're growing.
Is Patricia?
Crystal.
Crystal.
Yes.
Crystal's question is how to overcome negativity as you're building a business, whether that be your personal negativity or that's thrown at you. Second questioner.
Yes, ma'am. My name is Jonathan Bragg.
Oh, we met as I was walking through. Yes.
Yes, ma'am. I actually recently opened up my own business as well. And I manage independent artists and all types of talent all over the world. But I'm just not getting started, and I'm a small grassroots business. My question to you is, what are some of the challenges that you had to overcome when growing in different markets and expanding your business and territories?
Okay, what are some of the challenges I have overcome? And you speak as if that happened in the past, but you know, business is evergreen, so that continues to occur.
Yes,
I'll share with you current that may be relevant to you as well. Third questioner. Can he have a mic? And someone here had a question, I think. Stand up if you have a question so they can find you for the mic. And then this would be the next question, and then we'll start talking.
Okay, well, my name is John Taylor. We're with Taylor Funeral Home. Question to you would be, well, first, how did you think of the idea for your business, and do you enjoy what you're doing still?
Thank you. Fourth.
Hello, Jess.
Hi.
Thank you for coming today. My name is Donna Christian Lowe, and I'm the Chief Operations Officer for Main Street Innovations, Human Resources.
Mm-hmm.
So from someone who does exactly what you do in the field, I'd like to know two or three things, key toolkit, pieces of information that I can walk away with, something tangible to tackle today, gravitate today, and take with me, and
success
everyone here as
box.
Well.
Success in a box.
Helen Jones from Chattanooga Supporter Service. I've been in business for 5 years. And my question to you is, what were you driven by at the beginning, and are you still driven by the same thing now? And also, were you driven by passion, or were you driven by money?
Thank you. Thank you for that question. I'll start with your question. Now, I believe we've got those questions written up, and they're going to go up on the board. Is that true? Were you able to accommodate that? If not, we can continue. So, to your question about the question reverberated around how did I get started, and if I'm in that same place. I guess it would be easy to say, I was born by the river in a little tent. But I wasn't born in a tent. It was by the river. Okay, I did not grow up believing that one day I would be the founder and the leader of a multi-billion dollar human capital organization. As a matter of fact, I didn't even know what human resources was. I saw it in effect in my community. When I grew up over 60 years ago in Tarboro, North Carolina, grown men raised their families raking yards. Those weren't after school jobs. But I had a mom and a dad who had a vision, not just a vision. They had the capacity to actually teach, expect, examine, and most importantly, demonstrate what they wanted to have occur. Well, that's the answer to somebody's question right now, business in a box. You really have to be very clear about what your vision is. And let me just give you a pointer. Being clear on vision doesn't mean necessarily that you are you're steadfast to one idea. You truly have to be agile as the environment continues to change, Sherlinda. You have to be able to adapt around marketplace changes, but be constant on what your initial what your initiatives are and where you need to go. You cannot lead people wavering back and forth in uncertainty. You see, one question for me is, am I as passionate today as I was when I started my business? Well, if I weren't afraid I'd break these shoes, I'd jump up and go, I might give it a try. You know, hallelujah, yes. I am. I'm as passionate today as I was then. Are you laughing at me, baby? You never seen an old lady jump on heels, huh? I'm gonna tell you, some old ladies can do some things in heels. But the important thing is what we're doing in here. You know, and how well we communicate that forward. See, I said earlier, actually in preamble to talking with you, I stated I'd be very excited to talk about the ABCs of business. And I am going to just share that with you because Business in a Box is about that. I forgot your name, my fellow HR associate. What's your name? Donna, business in a box comes in ABCs. The A is you've got to ask the right questions and then listen for the right answer. You're at lunch, but you've got cell phones, take notes. You've got to ask the right questions. We walk around and the questions you've asked me are brilliant, but there are some I could think of better asked for you to value from my time. You've got to understand how to ask the right questions. We live in a world of social media today. It can make you or it can break you. It can share the good news or it can make you the news. And so when you ask questions today, you've got to understand that any communication you have, and you must be totally communicative, full circle communication is what is part of the C. But you've got to understand what questions you need to be asking. You've got to be able to target in to where you want to go in business. I'm so excited about all of the businesses in this room, and I can hardly wait to get back into the marketplace. Mary Kay already sold me some long-lasting lipstick I've got to go pay for. And I'm learning about folks who are working with young students around teaching them jazz at very young age and scholarshipping them to that. I'm excited to get into your marketplace. But as I walk through your marketplace, each of you who I stop in front of, I ask a particular question to. And that question leads me toward what I want to know about your business. You've got to, in business, ask the right questions and then listen for the right answers. Never, you wouldn't allow, how many of you have children? By show up, don't be ashamed. If you got them, own them. My second question is not what is your name and what is theirs. We are not going to know. But those of you who have children, you don't allow them to get away with not getting the right answers as they text through school. And you can't allow yourselves to do that in business either. The B in business in a box, Donna, is be where you say you're going to be, when you say you're going to be, and this is very important, how you say you're going to be? Why is it important that you have to be there how you say you're going to be? It seems obvious, but why is that? You laughed at me. What's your name?
I'm Zach. My name's Zach.
Zach, talk right there.
Into the mic.
Into the mic. Uh-huh. Come on, baby. Tell us.
What, could you repeat the question?
See, you weren't listening.
No, I was. It was the how, right?
Yes.
It was the how.
Answer the question, Zach.
Okay. Well, why is that important?
Mm-hmm.
Well, if you have to treat your customers right, and if you don't, if you're not passionate about what you're doing, and am I getting there?
Y'all, Zach is so flush. Who really wants to answer? He's got you started. Who really wants to answer that question? Why is the how so important? I will call for volunteers. Okay, I'm going to come over to you, sir. Be right, because I'm taking a long trek. Okay? Why is it so important, the how you say you're going to be there? Give your name as well.
My name is Kenny Fikes.
Kenny's got that heavy voice. Do you sing in church on Sunday?
I mumble in the back.
All right.
But it's important so that you are who you say you are and that you're reliable. I think it's not that complicated.
Reliability is the key.
Yes.
You nailed it, please. You nailed it. You, and he's going to follow me with this mic. He's thinking I'm going to ask somebody else to answer something, right? But how you say you're going to be there is the most important thing. Anybody can get there when they say they're going to, well, maybe some of y'all can't, but most people can get there when they say they're going to be there. And they usually have an idea of where that is. How you are when you show up is the most important thing. And there are some elements of being there, how you say you're going to be there. I'm going to shout out a couple, and then I'm coming to you to give me another one. What is it about how you say you're going to be there? Well, number one, you've got to be a good Boy Scout, a Girl Scout. What is that? Be prepared. Being prepared means you're information rich. When people come into my office and they want to sell something to me or talk with me about an initiative or get me engaged to do something, when Maria reached out to me, thank you, Maria, when Maria and Calvin reached out to my team to have me here, I needed information. I needed to understand why I was going to fly to Chattanooga, Tennessee in the middle of a really busy travel schedule already and invest time here. But they were information rich, and we knew what to ask to make sure that this would flow well. Another part of how you say you're going to be there is to make sure that you understand what resources are necessary toward that goal. Donna, I like you. You're a student. You take notes. Resourcing toward success is one of the most critical aspects of it. The Chamber of Commerce in Chattanooga, Tennessee is over 100 years old. That means they've been successful. You don't get to be 100 without doing something right. But they've seen value in creating diversity marketplaces because they understand not just the history of what needs to occur, but the future of what has to be. And they're adapting their current to that. They're resourcing you toward success. This is a beautiful vendor environment. I mentioned I speak all over the world. This is happening. This is happening. But there are some other elements about how you're going to be there. And yes, ma'am, I'm coming to you. You want a mic or you want my mic?
It's up to you.
How? What is another aspect of how you're going to be there? She's passing the mic.
I believe that, excuse me, that the presence that you make just in your appearance and your stature and your confidence has to come through in part of being prepared for that interaction so that the people that you're interacting with can gain that confidence back that you're going to provide what you
Absolutely.
Say you're going to provide.
Absolutely. What was your name, sir?
I'm Rick Cadena.
And your organization?
Marriott International.
Thank you. Thank you. I stayed at many of your hotels. And I take my candles and get my flowers and make it home. But you're exactly right. So being information rich, being fully resourced toward the opportunity, not lying and saying, I'm going to do it. You know, you can't be an aspirational leader on every front. At some point, you got to actually have something. And then understanding dynamically how to present that. How to present that isn't talking about what you have. It's talking about what they need to know in order to make a decision about what you have. I have people run up to me all over the place, and they're wanting to tell me about their business, and can you be a mentor, and blah, 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 blah. And I'm thinking, they don't really even know where I am in this. You see, to answer the rest of the questions already asked, I guess it would be best to share something with you that I've shared with my own team recently. We had our Agile One Forum in Charlotte, North Carolina, and I shared with my team members, and I'm in HR, I have to stay appropriate, but I shared with my team members what's so important about building business, because I get asked these questions all the time around, how do you go from being this little nappy-headed girl in Tarboro, North Carolina over 60 years ago to owning a privately held $3 billion organization? And my answer is, it's about faith. And you get my faith from a spiritual aspect, but I'm talking about some fundamental elements of faith. First, write it down, Donna. First, understand that you are a part of the world and not apart from it. There are many people, like the good folks at the chamber, who will work to help you succeed in your business. But the world is not about you. It is about you along with others. It is about inclusion. First, understand where you are in the world. You are not in that chair because of your own effort. You're in that chair because of many efforts before you. You will stand up from that chair based on your effort. And it's up to your effort whether others get a seat at that table. Amen. A, accept people from where they are, not from where you wish them to be. It is very easy as business people for us to want people to get on our agenda. Now, my boss is in here, Gail Gaines. A lot of people think Gail is my assistant, but she's my boss. If Gail doesn't tell me to do it, I don't get to do it. By the way, Maria, Gail is the reason I'm here, okay? Gail said, you need to be there. This is what you're about, Janice. You need to be there. Accept people from where they are, not from where you wish them to be. What do I mean by that? What do I mean by that?
Be true to yourself and to who they are.
And that's good that you received that. That's not what I mean by that. All right. Yes, ma'am.
Everybody has different talents and gifts that are unique to them. Everybody has different talents and gifts that are unique to them. We are not all created to be the same. There's no reason for us to try to be the same. We need to celebrate our differences. So you need to understand that people have value. And it may not be what you want it to be, or you need it to be, or you perceive it to be.
That's all I'm taking on.
Mm-hmm. Okay, good. So,
a sister getting hot in here.
I understand. Uh-huh. I understand. But just really accepting people where they are, and then all of us have capacity to grow and be and do more. But you're not going to change an individual overnight. You need to be able to influence that person to grow and develop. And we all need people in our lives to be able to help us do that. But respect the differences. Celebrate the differences.
Right, right, right. You've got to celebrate the differences. Here's what I'm talking about when I say accept people from where they are, not where you wish them to be. Dynamically within business, we need to get things done. And we hire people and we expect them to be able to meet a certain skill set. But these folks have lives outside of our businesses. There are things that are happening in their communities, in their homes, in their cubicles, that will impact how they are able to perform. If you don't understand where people are coming from, you can never lead them to where you wish them to go. What did I say? If you don't understand where people are coming from, you can never lead them to where you wish them to go. I, F-A-I, invest in others alongside yourself. It's very good and well to say, oh, Janice should donate to this organization or this cause, or she should be here for this or here for that because she's got it. I'm here today, and this is testimony to how my parents raised us, my mother and father. I'm one of 11 children, same mom, same dad. I'm here today because they taught me, Mama used to say, you always got something to give somebody else. And if you got enough of yourself and something for somebody else, you're doing pretty well. I was actually at university when I came to understand that I came from a poor family. I thought we were quite well off. We always had something to share with someone. And Mama could turn a really crazy, empty-looking refrigerator into a feast. Any of y'all know folks like that? You know, we could be waiting for Mom, and Mom would say, why didn't you get it started? Why didn't you get it started? Come on, business people. You know you've made feasts out of famine before. But you don't have to wait until your business is fully at a point you think or you call successful to invest in somebody else's good. You will be amazed at how many people you help along your way who end up helping you later along their way. It's just a law of life. It's a law of nature that if you invest in people as you are growing, you will grow and they will grow, and it keeps coming. It keeps on coming. T. F-A-I-T, to thine own self and to others be true. Now, I'm married to a man from Britain, so it's natural that I take a lot of interest in English writers, and to thine own self be true. Many of you have read that before. But for me, it really hits the mark when you understand that it's not just about being true to yourself. You can talk yourself into some stupid stuff and be very honest about it. It's about being true to others. It becomes very difficult to stay behind a veil of any sort, in denial, when you are asked to be true to others. And in building a business, you really have to operate more transparently today than ever before. It's not just about the technology that drives your reports or your trending. It's also about the technology that shares with your workers who you are as a person. Now, as I talk with you, I'm approaching a table full of Apple One and Act One employees. I can't stand up here and perpetrate a fraud to you, because they can tell you before I can get to that door if I'm truthful about what I share around the content and the conduct of our business and how I work as a leader. So it is very important as you're building your businesses, no matter what size they are, that you understand the law says you have to be true to others as well as yourself. And the H in how faith helps you build a business is about having healthy habits and a happy heart. Now, I laughed a little bit as I told you that I did not want to fall walking up those steps in stilettos. But without good health, I couldn't have gotten the stilettos on. You get what I'm saying? Amen? Amen. You've got to institute healthy habits into your lives. You've got to make sure that the people you're leading in your organization can depend on you to be where you say you're going to be. And health is part of that. And physical and mental health work alongside each other. You can't cheat every day, all day. Now, I know all of us have our moments. Yes, Calvin outed me. I do like cheesecake. And when I see it, I eat it first. But I'm also going to pick up some bottles of water, and before I drink them, what will I do? Come on, rock folks. What will I do? I'm a two-water girl. I'm going to pick up the big bottles of water, and I'm going to do my lifts, because I don't want the Oprah wings. I'm going to do my lifts. Oh, I want the wings in her home. Don't get me wrong. But I'm going to do the lifts before I drink the water. You get the idea. You got to be healthy, and it's easy to institute some health habits. And I speak about health all the time because it's so important to me that women who are dying one out of three of unnecessarily, that we just take care of ourselves. We take care of everybody but ourselves. Most women really wait till the last minute. And fellas, you got some beer guts too. You need to take care of yourself. But it's about healthy habits and happy hearts. Happy hearts. No matter what you don't have in your business, you can bring a happy heart to it. Now, I've been accused of being a Pollyanna from time to time. But I will tell you, a happy heart has gotten me over some really horrific hurdles in my life. And you can't be a person of any belief. I'm not talking spiritual here now, although if it applies, wear it. But you can't be a person of any belief in yourself and walk around with a saddened heart. You're going to have enough stuff that happens that can weigh on you. We all have had silent moments for what happened in Charleston, and we'll continue to have those. And even with the loving God, those moments will continue to happen until we all work collectively to understand that first, we are part of this world, not apart from it. We must accept people from where they come and not from where we wish them to be. And it is right that we invest in others alongside investing in ourselves. And that no matter what the subject, no matter what the answer, no matter what the question, that we are true to ourselves and to others. And that regardless of our financial circumstances, we all work from a level playing field when we work from healthy habits and happy hearts. And that brings me to the C of ABC. And that is about circular communication. Social media is wonderful. Technology certainly advanced my business. It's the fastest growing area of my enterprise. But none of it matters if we're not fully circular about it. Sending an email is not doing work in my organization. Gail, did we get so-and-so-and-so?
Yes.
Gail, did we get so-and-so-and-so?
I emailed them. I don't have the answer yet.
You got to have full circle communication. Pressing send is not the end of your communication. And you've got to balance circular communication. You've got to know how to do it in a way that it invites a response, not demands one. Because in a busy world, there are a lot of other emails waiting in most people's mailbox that they will respond to before yours, unless they have a provoking reason to answer that. So the opportunity for business in Chattanooga, your statistics as represented to the world are amazing. Simply amazing. Your chamber and your elected officials can be very proud of how folks who don't live here see here and get invited to come here to do business. But it is what you will do, one person, one company at a time, that will sustain and grow that environment. I certainly enjoy being here doing business here. Yes, I'm a taxpayer here like you. We live in a world where we can help so many people. There's a guy, I don't know, has anybody ever heard of somebody called Zig Ziglar? I heard some laughter. Laughter means recognition. What did old Zig teach us? What did old Zig teach us? Zig said you can help, you can get anything out of life you want if you'll just help enough other people get what they want out of life. Anybody don't believe that, raise your hand. Don't be ashamed. If you don't believe it, raise your hand. Then by lack of hands, that means everybody's on board. Everybody's on board. I can get anything I want out of life if I can help enough other people get what they want out of life. There are no secrets to success. The only secret is what you hold inside that you don't do. My husband and I taught our children from being very young this one truth. And I live it today, and they can complete it by rote for you. And they are over 30 years old. I have everything I need to be everything I need to be. Chattanooga, do you believe that? Do you believe that? Yes. Then say it with me. I have everything I need. To be every, y'all feel like you're in church. Come on. Take a deep breath. Sit up straight. I know it's dark in here. Sit up straight. Now, say it. I have everything I need to be everything I need to be. We're going to close with that thought, but I want to make sure that we're clear on what that means. Yes, I'm coming to you. What do I mean by I have everything I need to be everything I need to be?
Where is your mic?
It's right here, okay. Honey.
You mean that that inside of us we have everything that we would need to accomplish any of our goals and dreams.
You are absolutely right. Goals and dreams. And don't get your dreams confused with your goals, okay? All right? But there's an important part of it, and it's that last part, that I need to be. What do I mean when I talk about that I need to be?
Would it be your goals, and like it could be your short-term goals or like the tools that you, I don't know what I'm saying.
Well, that's an honest answer. She doesn't know. A lot of y'all don't know either, so don't laugh at her. I'm going to give you the answer in out of respect for time. That I need to be is about driving in your own lane. Don't look at somebody else's life and say, that's who I want to be. I've had people say, actually say, I want to be you. And I'm thinking, no, you don't. No, you don't. You don't know what I do to be me. But when you understand who you are and what you're prepared to bring to the table, and when you understand building a network that helps you to achieve that, and when you're prepared to be fully communicative about that, and you're not afraid of discipline, you embrace discipline as a freeing and evolving thing for you, then you too can be everything you need to be everything you need to be. I pray for you, Chattanooga. I pray you pray for me. God bless.
Janice, thank you so very much for being with us today and delivering the message that we could probably listen to every day and be better people for that. Calvin, thank you for your help in pulling our event together today. Maria, thank you for your help. And thank you to all of our members and guests that are with us here today. To the MAP family, I would say that I think James would have said we had a good day. Thank you as well for being with us today. There are almost 100 booths set up outside. Please walk by there slowly. You can spend some money if you want, or I have a feeling that Maria and Janice will be right behind you urging you to do that, and you might not want that yet. I'm going to complete our lunch today by reminding you that on August 19th is the Chamber's annual meeting in this place. We look forward to seeing you here then. Thank you very much for being with us today. Have a good afternoon.